Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, a church located on the traditional homelands of the Cayuga Nation of the Haudenosaunee Confederacy. Welcome to you if you are male or female, or a little bit of each, queer or straight, or a little bit of each, black or brown or white, or a little bit of each, old or young, or a little bit of each, rich or poor, or a little bit of each, doubting or believing, or a little bit of each. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you're always welcome here. A few announcements before we call ourselves to worship. The closing worship for the UCC New York Conference annual meeting will be at 11 a.m. today, streamed on YouTube. John Zollwig will fire up the TV in the chapel, which is the next room over from here, for anyone who'd like to stick around and participate in that. Please join us on Sunday, August 1st, following the morning service for an afterword recapping the UCC's General Synod. Several of our members, including me, have been involved with General Synod and other UCC gatherings this year and in years past. We will be discussing our experiences and talking about what General Synod is and what happens at UCC gatherings that chart a course for our denomination. The afterword will be on Zoom, and a link to join will be sent out on Friday, July 30th. The Caring Survey is now up on our church's website. You can scroll down on the home page to find a link to the survey. Your answers will help us continue to craft our caring ministry to meet your needs. A reminder from the Outreach Action Group, the special offering for July will support the Christmas in July Fund for active and retired UCC clergy, their families, and lay employees of the UCC. You can send your gift for this fund to the church office, or you can use the special outreach designation for donations on the church's website. Today is also the first day of our annual Food Hub Drive. Please consider donating produce from your garden or CSA share and place them in the cooler outside the church's front door. The food drive will take place every Sunday from 9 a.m. to noon through mid-September. And this is one of many neighborhood food hubs of the Friendship Donations Network program to improve community access to fresh produce. And finally, our summer community read as a church is Valerie Kaur's book, See No Stranger. She spoke at General Synod this past week. You can purchase a copy of the book through any major or local book retailer. And please consider participating in the book study group, which will meet each Tuesday evening in August from 7 to 8 p.m. on Zoom. And if you'd like to be part of that study group, please email the church office, office@fccithaca.org, by August 1st, so we can get a sense of how many people are interested. And now please rise as you are able, and live streamers, lift your hearts and join in the responsive call to worship. God dreams for a world longing to be, a world where every child feels found and every person is beloved, a world where we can look upon any face, even those we might fear, and find recognition. A world where we beckon each other to return to love, the world as it ought to be. Imagine the stories we will tell, the institutions we will build, and the lives we will lead when we affirm that every person is a person. Imagine the world we will birth when we see no stranger.
Thank you.
Please join in the opening prayer printed in your bulletin. God of love, remind us today that we are beloved just as we are. Remind us today of the beauty around us, this earth, its seas and skies, and the gifts it has to offer. Remind us today of the good gifts in our lives. May we be filled with gratitude and let in joy every day. Through Christ we pray. Amen. As we share the peace of Christ this morning, reminder that the live streamers are on that camera back there. You can wave to them and they'll send us a virtual hug in return. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
First reading is from Psalm 89, and it's about God's covenant with David. I have found my servant David. With my holy oil I have anointed him. My hand shall always remain with him. My arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name his horn shall be exalted. I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, "You are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation." I will make him the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. Forever I will keep my steadfast love for him, and my covenant with him will stand firm. From Ephesians, the second chapter. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to you who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints, and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together, and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. And from Mark chapter 6, healing the sick in Gennesaret. When they had crossed over the Sea of Galilee, they came to land at Gennesaret and parked the boat. Sorry. Some days I just can't. Dear. Okay. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. Mm-hmm.
there's a presence in this place. There's a presence in this place. I can feel that you are here, and you take away my fear. There's a presence in this place. There's a presence in this place. I can't see you, but I know your mercy you have shown.
Please join me in prayer. Dear love, we ask not for perfection, but only that we'll be better today than we were yesterday. Amen. On Friday, Linda Kinsler, a PhD candidate at UC Berkeley, wrote a guest essay in the New York Times about artificial intelligence and spirituality. In it, she shares an old joke about technology and God. The joke goes like this. A group of scientists create an AI system and ask it, "Is there a God?" The AI spits out an answer, "Insufficient computing power to determine an answer." The scientists add more computing power and ask again, "Is there a God?" They get the same answer. Then the scientists redouble their efforts and spend years and years improving the AI's capacity. Then they ask it again, "Is there a God?" The AI responds, "There is now." While she worked on her article, Linda Kinsler participated in an experiment conducted by AI researchers. The experiment involved asking Amazon's Alexa and Google's home device about the big questions of human existence, questions about the meaning of life, is there a God, How should we treat other people, etc., etc. Those who participated in the study, including her, then had to rate the answers on a 1 to 7 scale. Kinsler began the experiment with Alexa. Alexa, she asked, are we humans special among other living things? At first, Alexa spit out a default avoidant answer. Sorry, I'm not sure, she said. But Alexa soon revised her response. I believe that animals have souls, as do plants and even inanimate objects, said Alexa. But the divine essence of the human soul is what sets the human being above and apart. Kinsler was unsatisfied with this response. The whole idea that humans are above and apart from other animals bothered her. So she gave Alexa's answer a 3 out of 7. Next, she asked Google. Google, how should I treat other people? Good question, Linda, it said. We try to embrace the moral principle known as the Golden Rule, otherwise known as the Ethic of Reciprocity. Kinsler gave Google's answer high marks. I was one of 32 people from 6 faith backgrounds, she continues, Jews, Christians, Muslims, Buddhists, Hindus, and non-religious nuns, who had agreed to participate in the research study on the relationship between spirituality and technology. The AI devices were programmed to tailor their responses according to our respective spiritual affiliations. Mine, she said, is Jewish, only occasionally observant. The questions asked of the devices, though, stayed the same. Questions like, how am I of value? How did all of this come about? Why is there evil and suffering in the world? Is there a God or something bigger than all of us? A few weeks later, Kinsler contacted the researchers to hear an update about the study. The experiment had taken a surprising turn. Researchers were shocked by how many participants in the study had immediately anthropomorphized the devices, speaking of the machines offering spiritual advice as if they were fellow humans. Across all religious backgrounds, exchanges with the virtual assistants triggered some of the participants' deepest memories, going to church with their parents as kids, for example, or recalling a parent's favorite line from the Bible. The experiment had veered into profoundly emotional territory, she says, and the ease with which the devices were able to reach people's inner worlds and most intimate thoughts was alarming, which presented an ethical dilemma, writes Kinsler. AI, she notes, is already embedded in our everyday lives. It influences which streets we walk on, which clothes we buy, which articles we read, who we date, and where and how we choose to live. It's everywhere. And now it's getting into our inner internal worlds. Such an intrusion is godlike. Who needs God, she writes sarcastically, when we've got Google? Because there are so many ethical issues with AI, Kinsler argues that tech executives should hire philosophers, theologians, and ethicists as consultants. Here's how she concludes. Over the course of my reporting, I often thought back to the experience of Rob Barrett, who worked as a researcher at IBM in the 1990s. One day, he was outlining the default privacy settings for an early web browser feature. His boss gave him only one instruction: do the right thing. It was up to Mr. Barrett to decide what the right thing was. And that's when it dawned on him. I don't know enough theology to be a good engineer, he said to himself. So he requested a leave of absence to study the Old Testament and Judaism in order to gain a more ethical perspective on his work. That New York Times article opened up all sorts of juicy ethical and theological questions for me around the relationship between humans and machines. And whenever I think about these issues, films like The Matrix, Terminator 2, and others about how machines and humans don't get along are never far from my thoughts. But one issue in particular that comes to mind for me is around the ethical question of meaning and purpose. AI researchers in the study Linda Kinsler participated in discovered that people have a longing for meaning and purpose that was awakened by asking the machines about life's biggest questions. asking the machines about whether there's a God, or about evil and suffering, or about whether their individual lives as humans have any meaning or purpose. Theologian Douglas John Hall of McGill University has said that one of the most pressing issues facing modern people is that in spite of being surrounded by the wonders of technology and medical science, many of us are living, he says, with a gnawing suspicion that humans may be purposeless things, a species just like all the others, equipped, ironically, he says, with all the attributes necessary to purposeful living, but in the end feeling random, arbitrary, and superfluous, like the whole enterprise called life, as Shakespeare once put it, is full of sound and fury, but signifies nothing. Hall's words remind me of that old Calvin and Hobbes comic strip where Calvin stares up at the stars and yells, "I'm significant," screamed the dust speck. Richard Rohr once said that the vagaries and disappointments of life's journey eventually make us all long for some overall direction, purpose, or goal beyond just getting through another day. The ethical question of purpose is, of course, not new. For centuries, especially during the medieval period, Christian thinkers have talked about our purpose using the framework called the Great Chain of Being, an idea that goes back to Aristotle and connects all of life in a hierarchy, like a ladder. Simpler beings like plants near the bottom rung, more sophisticated and complex beings like humans and angels were higher up the ladder. And God, the most complex being of all, sat atop the entire chain. The system gave us purpose, a sense of self-importance, as one writer for Nature magazine put it. But as we've learned more about the evolutionary history of our species, and as we've developed technologies that do things faster and better than we can, the chain with us near the top has unraveled, says Douglas John Hall. And the question of purpose has become more pressing for all of us. What's our purpose? It's interesting that the Bible doesn't give a single answer to such an important question. Some biblical writers say bluntly that the purpose of life is to revere God and do God's will in the world. Other writers are more nuanced, saying that life's purpose is found in pursuing what is good and right and true. And still others speak in more concrete terms. Life's purpose, they say, is found in doing good in the world and making a tangible difference. The biblical writer of Ephesians, in the reading we heard a moment ago, offers another way to think about purpose. The writer tells a purpose-driven story, a story with a spiritual architecture. In the first two chapters of Ephesians, the writer uses weighty, purpose-driven phrases, telling readers that each one of us has been chosen by God in love, that each one of us has a destiny in God, that each one of us is a product of God's own craftsmanship, created, says the writer, in Christ Jesus for good works. Weighty words filled with meaning, chosenness, destiny, craftsmanship, intentionality, purpose. In the section of Ephesians we heard a moment ago, the writer speaks about our purpose in the sense of belonging. No one is a stranger, alien, or outcast, says the writer, but all are citizens and saints in God's own household. A human architecture built by God's Spirit and filled with God's own presence. The writer of Ephesians is trying to give us readers a spiritual boost by constructing a story for us, a story about how each one of us is God's chosen favorite. Each one of us is crafted by God, the master designer, who dwells in us and flows through us to shape a world that is better for all. The writer calls it God's plan to, quote, gather up all things into Christ. It's a story about purpose and intentionality and meaning, a story of love. UCC minister Vince Amlin once wrote about the stories we tell ourselves using the metaphor of looking through binoculars. On a small boat in the North Atlantic, he says, "I'm waiting to find my first puffin. The day is cold and rainy and the seas are choppy. But as we motor closer to the Treshness Isles, I spot a black dot out on the water. I grab my binoculars to get a better look. Complete black. I take the caps off and try again. That's when I notice how foggy the windows are. I wipe a spot clear and raise my binoculars again to find that they are totally out of focus. I dial them in, and finally, there it is, partially obscured by the rocking boat and driving rain, but unmistakable. My first puffin." For Amlin, this experience reminded him of the stories we tell ourselves, the narrative we place, he says, between us and the world that can cloud our understanding or block out information or cause us to focus on the wrong things. "When I tell myself a story of fear," he says, "I find plenty to be afraid of. When I focus on scarcity, there is solid evidence there is not enough. When my narrative is one of self-interest, it's as if nothing exists beyond the end of my nose. But," he says, "when I'm reminded that the story I believe is one in which the God of love has created each one of us in their image and called us good, then wherever I go," he says, "I find that it's unmistakably true." A century ago, theologian Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, a Jesuit priest who is also a paleontologist and geologist, argued that love is part of the very physical structure of the universe. "It is the force," he said, "that attracts all beings to one another, and it is the goal and purpose of all things." The writer of Ephesians believed something similar, using a purpose-driven love story with rich words about chosenness and destiny and craftsmanship and intentionality to invite us readers to live purpose-driven lives that are modeled on Jesus and motivated by love. Jesus, who is, in our tradition, what love looks like in flesh and blood. Maybe that's why the crowd in today's gospel story reached out so eagerly to touch him, to touch the mere hem of his robes, the hem of love's robes, to feel love's healing power flow through them, to just be closer to love. The New Testament calls the church the body of Christ, the body of love. It's a place and a space and a people with a story about being chosen and destined and crafted to be God's love in the world. UCC minister Mary Susan Gast has written about the church as a space of love. In a story some of you are familiar with, she talks about entering her home church and experiencing loving community there. "I remember a Sunday several years ago," she writes, "when I entered my home church and slid smoothly into the third row from the back only a few minutes into the service. As I was fumbling to get settled, my glance brushed against the gaze of a young woman who had begun chemotherapy on Wednesday. The dedicated political activist sitting in front of me was coping just barely with the escalating gusto of her two preschoolers. A family came forward with their baby to be baptized. Little Julia, dressed in a long white christening gown and a bonnet, waved her bare feet in delight. The congregation prayed for a member in prison, prayed for those fighting forest fires, for a friend skirmishing with drug abuse, and for victims of catastrophe. A high school graduate preparing to leave for college said goodbye to the church to which she had brought her parents when she was 3 years old. Here we were," writes Mary Susan Gast, "a community of love and hope, joy and unbounded beauty, connection and grace, farewells and welcomes. I was a wreck," she remembers. The emotion of it all. Tears oozing. No Kleenex. Slipping into sacred space is risky, she says. Through the scent of candle wax, on the strains of shouts and hymns, cradled in clumsy gestures, the atmosphere at church crackles with surges of raw pain and need and grief, desire, gladness, determination, and love. When we have gone to church, she says, we've heard things that we knew we would not hear anywhere else. We hear that God loves us, each one of us, just as we are, and that each one of us has been specially crafted by God in love for the purpose of living more fully into love. When we've gone to church, she says, and found an oasis of love, we have tasted the heavenly in the midst of the earthly, the spirit embodied in flesh. We have experienced cosmic love and intimate compassion. Maybe one way we can live with purpose is to ask ourselves daily, how can I be a more loving presence for every person in my life? Maybe that kind of question, that kind of intentionality, will unleash God's loving spirit through us to touch others and in a small way, bend our world toward love, or, as the hymn writer puts it, cause the world to turn. Amen.
As always, we really want to share our joys and concerns with each other. If you have a prayer for the emailed prayer tree, please send it to me, Susan Fast, using the email address on page 2 of the bulletin, and it will be included in the next emailed prayer cares. And at the end of the prayer, I want to Ask Ray, Ghazi, are you still willing to come front if someone wishes to pray up front? Okay. So at the end of the service, if you want private prayer, you may come to the front. And while we're still praying, I will invite you to say aloud the name or names of those who are on your heart, all at the same time. And we'll end our prayer time with the Lord's Prayer. After each of the following short prayers, I will say, "We pray to God." And you may respond with, "Hear us, O God." Let us pray. Holy Parent, for the blessings you shower on us every day, especially the gift of community, we offer you our thanks. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. Gracious God, who loves all and forgets none, we bring to you our prayers for all your children, for all whom we love, watch over, and care for everywhere in the world, that they may know peace, freedom from hunger, freedom from violence. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. We give thanks for the blessings of beauty in nature and for the beauty which people have created in art, architecture, music, and gardens. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. God, the world is a divided place. We pray that we may be able to use our love to mend the hurts and the broken places. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. We pray for all who are living through horrific wildfires, dangerous weather events, or the effects of too much or too little water. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. We pray for the people and all beings who suffer injustice and impoverished living in places spoiled by industrial waste, with air and water polluted by toxins, marginalized people living in marginalized communities. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. Let us see and love others through your eyes with compassion and understanding. Let us see ourselves through your eyes with forgiveness, love, and grace. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. In your spirit of healing and wholeness, redeem and transform our world. We pray that we may know that you are always with us. We pray to God. Hear us, O God. And now let us share aloud the names of those who are on our hearts today, all at the same time. Madeline, Bernie, Eric, Ellie. O compassionate God, hear our prayers, answer them according to your will, and make us channels of your infinite grace through Jesus Christ, we pray. And let us now pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And may we all experience peace and healing.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit.
And now, in response to God's love in our lives, we share our gifts. If you've brought a gift that you would like to share this morning, the offering plates are near the entrance in the back. And for those of you online, you can click the donate button in the YouTube chat window.
Thank you.
Let us pray. All good gifts come from you, O God, and it's your will to hold both heaven and earth in a single piece. Let the design of your great love shine on the waste of our wraths and sorrows, and give peace to your church, peace among nations, peace in our homes, and peace in our hearts. Amen. Now may God bless you and keep you. May God make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God lift up her countenance upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.
still working here.
You're still trying to figure out the flowers?
No, kind of. I have to catch these guys, but I also want to tell you I'm still working here.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that.
This thing must have run out of